Hello everybody. In the previous video, I addressed some of the operational limits of an aircraft. In this video, I will continue that discussion, starting with gust loads. During flight, gusts and turbulence can be encountered. Now, based on statistics of the atmosphere, the magnitude of gusts that will be encountered during the lifetime of an aircraft can be determined. If an aircraft suddenly encounters such a gust, then the angle of attack will change immediately. It is as if you would drive with a car over a speed bump. With a car, it is better to drive slowly over speed bumps, and the same holds for aircraft encountering a gust. So what does this mean for the structural loads inside the airframe? Now, the structural loads are defined by the load factor as lift divided by weight. Now, if we encounter a gust, we will have a change, a delta, in the load factor. And this change is the result of a delta change in the lift. And of course, this is still divided by the weight. So what would be the delta lift? Now, we've just seen that the aircraft experiences a change in the angle of attack. So we will get a change in the lift coefficient. And then half rho v squared in the lift equation becomes a half rho times the original v squared at which the aircraft is flying plus u squared, which is the gust magnitude. And of course, this must be multiplied with the wing surface area. So in a small diagram, you can see that is, if this is the aircraft and it's flying at velocity v, then this would originally be the angle of attack. So this would be the angle of attack original. And if we encounter a gust, then the total speed would be this vector, v squared plus u squared. And the change in angle of attack, this angle here, delta alpha, you can find by simple trigonometry, and it equal to the inverse tangens of u divided by v. Now, in practice, u will be quite a lot smaller than v because airplanes fly pretty fast, and the gusts, of course, are much smaller in magnitude. So you could actually say that this whole relation here can be simplified by saying, well, that's almost the same as v squared. You can also say that the change in angle of attack is actually almost the same as u over v. So if we have a u which is much smaller than v, then it will be a small change in angle of attack. So we can simplify this by removing the inverse of the tangens. Now, of course, we're interested in this change in lift coefficient, and we all know how lift coefficient changes with angle of attack. So if I plot alpha on the x-axis and CL on the y-axis, then typically for an aircraft, it looks more or less like this, a straight line up until the stall, CL max. Now, the angle that this graph makes over here is what we call dCL d alpha. So the change of lift coefficient with angle of attack. And over the largest portion of this graph, dCL d alpha is more or less a constant. So if we have a change in angle of attack, then delta CL will be equal to dCL d alpha times delta alpha. And delta alpha we've just calculated over here. So what does this mean? That our change in lift is actually dC L d alpha times the delta alpha, which is u divided by v, times a half rho v squared s. Now, and since we have a v here and a v squared there, we can remove one v. And if we then want to see what is the load factor, so if we want to know what is delta n, we have to divide the whole equation by weight. Now, if you look at all these terms, actually dCl, the alpha, is constant. U is a given factor. This is the gust. A half is constant. If we consider flying at a specific altitude, then air density is constant. Wing surface area is, of course, constant. And if we consider one moment in time, then the aircraft weight is also more or less constant. So this means that our delta n is in fact a constant. Let's call it k. If we put all the constant factors in this k, multiplied with this magnitude of the gust velocity, multiplied with the airspeed at which we are flying. So a fairly simple equation. Just like the maneuver envelope, we can now make a gust envelope. So let's draw equivalent airspeed versus load factor. The airworthiness specifications have specified the gust to be considered at the design cruise speed and below. For a constant U, the delta n as a result of a gust relative to the condition where the load factor equals 1 becomes a straight line. At VC, the resulting gust load is maximum. Similarly, the airworthiness authorities have specified a gust with a lower magnitude to be considered for the design dive speed. Again, we can draw a line from the origin. Now we have a complete gust envelope. The aircraft must be designed to be able to cope with the loads in this envelope. And it is possible to combine this gust envelope with the maneuver envelope obtained in the previous video. Let's now overlap both figures. The combined limits are those that should be considered when the aircraft structure is designed. I should make one final note about this figure, that on the x-axis we have equivalent airspeed instead of true airspeed. By doing so, we only need a single diagram instead of different diagrams for different altitudes. Concluding, the airframe is designed to withstand the load factor airspeed combinations indicated in the maneuver and gust load envelopes. The maximum airspeed in these diagrams is the design dive speed. It is a constant equivalent airspeed. However, expressed as a true airspeed, it is in fact changing with altitude. The equivalent airspeed is defined by making use of the air density at sea level, thus half rho v true airspeed squared equals a half rho v equivalent airspeed squared. Consequently, the design dive speed expressed as a true airspeed becomes vd, as a true airspeed is the square root of rho at sea level divided by the actual rho multiplied with the design dive speed as an equivalent airspeed. So, based on this equation, it increases with increasing altitude. Now, this speed limit should never be exceeded. In order to be on the safe side, a small safety margin has been defined by the regulatory bodies with respect to the design dive speed. This limit is called the maximum operating speed. This is the first operational limits we can draw in a velocity altitude diagram, the flight envelope. Now let's have a look at the other operational limits, starting with the maximum Mach number. The lift drag polar we have used so far was either a one-term or a two-term polar, with the factors k being constant. However, what I did not yet tell you is that these factors k gradually change when the Mach number is increased. At some point, when the speed of sound is approached, the aerodynamic behavior can change quite drastically. Even at subsonic speeds, the airflow can locally become supersonic. This can be explained with a schematic representation of an airfoil and its streamlines. The flow accelerates along the chord of the airfoil. So even though the aircraft is flying subsonic, locally the flow may accelerate to a supersonic level, creating a supersonic region of air. The Mach number at which one point on the airfoil reaches Mach 1 is called the critical Mach number. Supersonic flow is associated with shock waves and it may significantly shift the aerodynamic center. Now, it is not my intention to explain these effects in great detail. That would be a topic of an advanced lecture on aerodynamics. The only thing we need to take from these observations is that two things can happen at Mach numbers approaching Mach 1. Shock waves start to appear on the aircraft, which can result in undesirable buffeting, which are vibration. And secondly, a shift in the aerodynamic center can cause a severe pitch motion. Aerodynamic control surfaces may become less or ineffective as a final factor. Now, due to these effects, it's dangerous to fly at high Mach numbers with an aircraft that is not specifically designed for it. Therefore, commercial aircraft typically have a maximum Mach number at which they are allowed to fly. If we would draw the maximum Mach number in the speed versus altitude diagram, since Mach number is a function of temperature, the corresponding airspeed decreases with altitude. A constant Mach number, therefore, will result in a decreasing speed limit with increasing altitude. Now, beyond 11 kilometers altitude, temperature remains constant in the international standard atmosphere, and thus the speed limit associated to the maximum Mach number as well. Again, in order to be on the safe side, a small safety margin has been defined by the regulatory bodies with respect to the maximum Mach number. This limit is called the maximum operating Mach number. Now let's have a look at the final operational limit, the limits associated to the pressurized cabin. Commercial aircraft typically fly at about 10 kilometers altitude. In order to create a nice environment in the aircraft for the passengers, the cabin is pressurized. Now, the difference between the internal pressure and the external pressure on the aircraft creates stresses in the fuselage structure. Now, the fuselage structure is designed for a maximum pressure differential. So, there is a maximum flight altitude at which the aircraft is allowed to fly before the pressure differential becomes too large. This limit can also be drawn in the velocity altitude diagram. It is simply a straight horizontal line indicating the maximum flight altitude. So, now I have addressed all three operational limits: the maximum operating speed, the maximum Mach number, and the maximum flight altitude. Let's combine all these limits in one diagram. You should note that these limits are fixed. The performance limits can exceed or lie within these boundaries. Furthermore, the performance limits depend on the aircraft weight as well. This complete picture gives us the altitude and airspeed to which the aircraft is constrained for a specific aircraft weight. We call this the flight envelope. And this is our final result, a very important figure for an aircraft operator. Next time, I will briefly address how the pilot will deal with all these varying limits using his or her instruments.